Right. So our treaty acknowledgement, the community of St. James Assiniboia has deep indigenous roots. These lands and waters are the traditional territories of Anishinaabe, the Ininuak, the Dakota, Dene, and Ininishiwak peoples. It is the birthplace and homeland of the Red River Métis Nation. It is also home to members of the Inuit Nation. Our community is bound by Treaty 1. Our water flows from Shoal Lake 40, First Nation in Treaty 3, and our buildings are powered by Northern Manitoba in Treaty 5. We're all tied together through the treaties that were signed across these lands. These treaties come with responsibility to the land, the waters, the animals, and each other. We are committed to honor and learn about the true history of this place and to our part to move our community forward in a true spirit of justice and reconciliation.
Thank you very much. Beautifully read. We were a little worried we were going to trip and stumble, and I have had North Star try to prompt me through it, and I still had difficulty. So I got to remember to stay in my sweet spot here, because this is being recorded for posterity, or perhaps just to take it up and put it up on the site. Supporting students with challenging behavior. One of the things, it's going to be a little different, the format. So it's going to be the first half, we will be kind of uploading content and a couple of activities. And after the break, we're actually going to be working through a positive behavior support plan using a case study. And one of the things I want to talk about too, study after study, whether it's teacher survey, administrator survey, looking at frequency data, definitely challenging behavior has increased, post-COVID. And it's a variety of reasons, increase in mental health challenges, financial stressors. We were at a school and the administrator queried as to whether they were the only school that was dealing with challenging behavior. Were they unique in that sense? And the coordinator and I made eye contact and we shook our heads no. So it's also happening within this division. When you start to query, when you start to ask people, they indicate that challenging behavior is increasing. And it's the complexity of the challenging behavior that's increasing. It's not just the kids. If you look at some incidences on airlines in the United States, for example, pre-COVID, there was 183 in a year. Now it's 5,000 in a year. So even the adults are presenting with challenging behaviors. And within the context of a school, and this is, I think, is one of the best definitions of challenging behavior, is that it interferes with the safety or learning of that student that's displaying or presenting with challenging behavior. It is also interfering with the safety or learning of other kids in that classroom, those learners who want to learn as well. It interferes with the safety of school staff. So it is all of that is what constitutes challenging behavior. Within the literature on challenging behavior, and trust me, there is a lot, the approach that is advocated frequently is kind of a functional assessment approach, that all behavior happens for a reason. Our job is to figure out what that reason is, what's the payoff for that behavior, and put a plan in place to support that student. And frequently, the supports can be embedded within kind of a tier one approach, all the way up to a tier three approach. These are just various genres of challenging behaviors, but we are just going to focus really on when you ask teachers in some of the surveys I read, what was the most challenging? Obviously, aggression in the classroom, either verbal or physical aggression. But so too is this disruptive behaviors, the out-of-seat behaviors, the talking back, the oppositionality, kind of interfering with the flow of instruction, and kind of derailing, maybe possibly an assessment activity, and having an impact of those other kids in the classroom as well. And we'll be also focusing on violent or unsafe behaviour, and really about the aggression, the physical aggression, the kicking and biting and scratching, etc., as well as lopeman behaviours, running away, and to destruction of property. Sometimes in the act of destroying property, that child was at risk of harm to self or using it to harm others. Now, there's often, these are just a select few of diagnoses that frequently will co-occur with challenging behavior. ADHD being a really big one, especially unmedicated. If you think about it, these kids can be impulsive. They don't stop and think. They may quickly fly. These kids will often also have a lot of difficulty with emotional regulation, really big emotions, especially if they're not on the right level of a medication. Kids who are on the spectrum, somebody bumps into them. One of the things we know, the kids on the spectrum, they have real difficulty inferring the mental state of others. It's called theory of mind. So putting themselves in the other person's shoes and thinking, oh, well, maybe they tripped and stumbled and it wasn't on purpose. So that can result in challenging behavior with kids on the spectrum. Definitely learning disabilities, whether dyslexic or intellectual disability, work is hard, and their behavior may escalate as well. Oppositional defiant disorder, definitely kids with trauma often frequently display oppositional defiant disorder. If you're raised in a chaotic environment, this is a great way to control others, the adults in that, you know, in that classroom, in that school. Definitely it's often correlated with trauma, and that's just a response to the chaos. Definitely anxiety, OCD, and communication deficit. Sometimes if you don't have the words to describe you're feeling frustrated, if you don't have the words to describe you're feeling, you know, anxious, you may upend a desk as a way to communicate with the people, the adults in the classroom or in the building or even to your peers. I think there was an old saying that kids wear their emotions in their behavior and their feelings in their behavior, and our job is to kind of decipher what they're saying and then using that data to put a plan in place. When we track these kids as they go up through our system and beyond it, we know there's a number of adverse adverse outcomes, such as underachievement. And as they go up the gray ladder, definitely this becomes a big thing. They start to be rejected by their peers, but you can really see it even in the early years. There's that look askance. They're not making eye contact. The other kids are not making eye contact. But their peer rejection definitely becomes more active as their peers just become more verbal. And definitely too, we know that there's a real high rate of school dropout. And if some of those challenging behaviors that are displayed in the classroom, when they're displayed in the place of employment, they frequently will lose that job. So they really do have really high rates of unemployment. Depression and substance use or misuse or abuse are another correlate as they kind of age out of our system, and definitely legal system involvement. If you display challenging behavior outside of a school system, definitely the legal system becomes involved, especially as you turn a certain age. And so the emphasis within the literature is let's focus on supporting these kids, putting a plan in place, making that payoff for challenging behavior less, and increasing the payoff for positive behaviors, if only to circumvent those negative outcomes that we know it can be in these kids' future when they leave our system. So the approach today, you know, many of the strategies are going to kind of be tier one, but some of the strategies, like choice being such a powerful thing for oppositional kids, especially if they have trauma, are strategies that can not only work in the general classroom, but also work and should be embedded in that positive behavior support plan. I mean, we'll be talking preventative / proactive. In some sense, we're going to rebrand the proactive to make really as preventative, as preventing that challenging behavior occurring. And so it's going to be all the way from tier one, tier two, to tier three. The reality is some of these kids do need a safety plan as well. The safety plan, having a plan in place when there is a need to maybe clear a classroom, for example, really helps because you know what to do. Knowing where the exits are when that plane is plummeting to the ground actually results in a higher rate of survival. So having that plan in place, knowing what to do, knowing what everyone else should do, is really effective. And parents do love a safety plan. They do know that these are the circumstances and these are the circumstances in which you'll support their child. And really, it's all about working together to do so. So there's a number of influences on student behavior. As I'm talking, think about some of the kids that you're dealing with that are presenting a challenge, either in the general classroom, maybe not at high frequency that you have to do a positive behavior support plan, but this kind of informs and helps you help that child going forward. We talked definitely about things like a learning disability definitely being can have an impact, increasing the likelihood of challenging behavior. But so too, psychological factors. Definitely kids with ADHD and kids with autism, some of the things they have in common is a problem with social skills. For a kid with autism, it's difficulty reading the nonverbal signals, the sarcasm goes right over their head. But for kids with ADHD, they may not know how to get positive attention. They may act out in the classroom or on the playground, and they're fine with negative attention. They just want that peer interaction. And sometimes targeting the social skills is a way to help them. And we know definitely kids with learning disabilities, such as dyslexia, if you ask them to read out loud, they may run from the classroom, they may shut down, or they may throw a desk, and it's all an attempt, so you don't know that I can have trouble with reading. And definitely for some, there are historical community factors. If you read just the legacy impact of the residential schools, it is something that kind of cascades throughout the subsequent generations. And so there is a negative perception of school. School is neither a fun place to be, and importantly, nor is it a safe place to be. Sometimes too, I've seen kids who was one who was a frequent victim of bullying, just get up from a desk, leap across two rows, and assault his bully right in the general classroom. But we're also really going to be focusing on the bullies themselves to some extent, the focus of this presentation, or kids who are the bullies, and just how hard it is to get rid of that behavior. And sometimes too, what can trigger and result in an increase in challenging behavior is just something as simple as the level of classroom noise, classroom seating arrangements. There is a sense within the literature that rows are making a comeback, and you pull them together for a group activity, but if you want to upload direct instruction, we're back to rows now. And sometimes too, it's inconsistent routines. Can be a challenge, especially for kids who maybe maybe trauma, or they just need, I love having my day planner, knowing exactly what's going to happen in my day. So something as simple as a visual schedule, yes, even in senior years, is a really powerful and yet cheap intervention. And sometimes it's overreaction to misbehavior or over-reliance on punishment. But they're flipping on its other side, because I have seen behaviors that should have been acknowledged in the classroom were ignored. And that really had an impact on the other kids in the classroom, had an impact on the classroom culture for that. So that can be equally as detrimental to not only that child that's displaying the challenge in behavior, but those learners who want to learn the impact on their behavior and enjoyment of the educational experience. The reality is complex problems don't have simple solutions. They just don't. When you talk to people in the school systems, they say, oh man, challenging behavior is increased. But they've also repeated stressing that the problems are just more complex. It's not just one thing. It is multiple things. And here too, sometimes it's not just going to be one influence. It'll be multiple influences. It'll be maybe there's trauma, but maybe a family member lost a job, or maybe that child had a fight with somebody. There's multiple factors all collectively resulting in an increase in challenging behavior in the classroom, and we have to support it. The reality is too, you know, this is the best job in the world. We get to work with kids. And I definitely have had some really good times with many of you at staff meetings, at ESS meetings, defined benefit pension plan in addition to that. But it is having to make do with less. Collaboration is such a powerful, way to go because we are in some sense able to come up with all these great ideas, and I've seen it happen, the power of collaboration. Definitely, you know, you want to decrease challenging behavior, you increase positive behavior. So structure and predictability is so powerful. I love it. I love my daily planner. So something as visual schedules, something when you think about some of the challenges are occurring, is there unclear transitions occurring? Does that kid need to have, you know, definitely something concrete like a visual schedule? And even in senior years, visual schedules work. Really, and we're all guilty of this. Man, we are all over, even our family members, when they display challenging behavior. When they display positive behavior, maybe not so much. So it's being more mindful of that, being more aware. Are we really noticing that positive behavior and focusing on saying something? Even those kids in the classroom who are definitely sitting there following along, are we acknowledging it? Right, because sometimes you can enlist the kids who are there, the learners who want to learn in the classroom to support or divert the attention from the challenging behavior that's occurring in the classroom. Now, we used to have, you know, behavior intervention plan. It is now rebranded as a positive behavior support plan. Really, that's just an evolution, moving from what not to do to what to do. And some sense, these kids do need a what to do focus because they may not have that particular skill in their repertoire. Now, I've said this 100 times, but definitely, you know what, so does the literature, and you know it. I mean, frequently, you know, when we've done an assessment, it's like, oh my God, now suddenly this child does make sense. This is why this kid has been struggling in the classroom. I've had kids in senior years, we do a resource assessment, the kid's reading at a grade one, grade two level, suddenly their behavior does make sense. Or maybe there's an undiagnosed dyslexia. And definitely talk to the teacher and look at those report cards as well. Definitely too, sometimes making sure that you're putting in appropriate learning opportunities and activities, definitely tapping into that kid's strengths. And sometimes, you know, definitely making sure that modification is more than just reducing the number of questions. Sometimes looking at the goals and objectives, and maybe they don't have to calculate slope, but maybe financial literacy, seeing the impact of credit card debt on, you know, on one's monthly income. You know, we all want autonomy, and this becomes really critical as we go up the grade ladder, the middle and senior years. So providing opportunities for choice making. Make your life easier, choice between two things. Do you want to do 6 math problems or 2 math problems? I know what I would opt for. And you want to be in control but not controlling. Definitely for kids, for a variety of reasons, especially those trauma kids, FASD kids, kids with ADHD, oppositional defiant disorder, power and control is everything. So definitely giving them a choice, but you are in control of those choices. And it could be something as simple as you can finish that work sitting down or standing up. And sometimes, you know, you do have to do that assessment piece, but you can bias it so you'll get a good answer. Would you rather start with read to self or writing? So it's just about thinking ahead and biasing your choices so you get the answer you want. And we know chunking is so powerful and it works. And sometimes too, for kids within a positive behavior support plan, maybe there should be some academic strategies embedded in there, making sure that you are definitely breaking down that work. And if you think about it, you know, there's a concept called the reinforcement sandwich, something good, something bad, something good. The way the human brain works, it kind of remembers the first thing and it remembers the last thing. So at the end of that classroom, you want them to have a period of instruction, you want them to have a positive memory I definitely end on a high note, do something fun. If you start off with something that they don't like, follow it quickly by something they like. And it really is just making it less overwhelming, more enjoyable, and hooking them into the activity. Because in essence, we are a school. Now, I know. I often ask myself, what grade would I have liked? I was going to move to my sweet spot there. But I often ask myself, what would level of school would I have wanted? I could say categorically yes to elementary or high school. That you need a different mindset for middle years, and I thought this was very, very out there. Neither kids nor are they teenagers, but they definitely can present with more challenges, and there seems to be this kind of, you know, grade 10, it's like, okay, who's that adult walking through the building? But at the same time, high school does present with its unique challenges, as illustrated, like look what my first graders drew for me today. Versus what the senior year student drew for that teacher. It's kind of self-evident. Now, why I've included this is because there is a sense, when I have presented on this kind of behavior before, is that, you know, a lot of these strategies I talk about, noticing positives, the use of rewards, well, that works early years, not so much middle. And senior years, and there's a whole slew of literature indicating otherwise. I will be talking about one particular, it's called a systematic review. So they looked at a whole bunch of, the focus was on disruptive behavior in the classroom all the way to kind of the aggression in the classroom. We know what works, what did teachers, and importantly this study also had information on what students endorsed. What did they thought worked, was it effective? So here is the teacher data. So strategies for increasing positive behavior in the classroom. So even teachers said, you know what, the rewards work. They found that to be particularly effective. And there's all kinds of positive reinforcement strategies, tangible rewards, that's called the Skittle. A praise, you know, that everyone likes praise. Preferred activity, free time is effective for increasing positive behavior. If you target positive behavior, you're going to have a decrease in challenging behavior. Definitely student autonomy, promoting that, and a good way to do that is through choice. Clear communication about appropriate behavior, the teachers found that to be very effective. And sometimes it is putting those classroom rules short and sweet and putting it up and laminating it, whether it's an early, middle, or senior year's classroom, and open discussion with students, and really kind of a key prompt for reflective practice is remaining open and respectful. There is an old, Marine Corps dictate, praise in public and reprimand in private. However, there are times, man, you've got to reprimand in public when someone's going across, leaping across three desks. Well, so it really is more, being more mindful of that going forward. So what did the kids say? What items did they endorse? Yeah, they want to be recognized for positive behavior. The adults in the building, are you acknowledging positive behavior more often than challenging behavior? I think if we kind of reflect upon that, we'll notice them, maybe not as much as we need to do that. I'm as guilty as anyone. Definitely when I see, you know, my family member do something, I'm all over them. They do something right and nothing. So use of praise and rewards, they find that really helpful. But it has to be meaningful. You know, you give me 10 minutes of free time after I finished my work in the classroom, and you say you have 10 minutes of art, not meaningful to me. Not my bag. So it has to be something that a kid wants, could be 10 minutes or 5 minutes of, you know, maybe read to self, maybe it is art for some kids. And clear communication about expected behavior, yeah, they're still kids. So definitely making them clear, positive, understood, and not being singled out. So maintaining awareness of the impact of the negative public reprimand at the same time too, I can still remember my teacher turning to me in grade 9 and saying, Maria, if you don't shut up, I'm going to wring your neck. And you know what? It was a consequence. Boy, we had a great relationship. She loved me and I loved her. But she probably would be escorted out of the classroom today. I did shut up, and she was able to go on with the classroom. There are times you do have to address that behavior, because we all live in the real world. So you can see, like, keep the class rules simple, positive. Display your rules so every student can see. Sometimes too, it really is positive, engage, respect. But something as simple as that, sometimes you put an early year's poster up in a senior year's room, and it really kind of resonates with the kid. It's like, getting a sticker for when you voted, or getting a sticker for when you were first vaccinated. I wore it with pride. And so just focusing on their strengths sometimes. Sometimes we see their strengths, but we don't say anything about it. And it's such a simple little intervention. Now we're going to talk a little bit about behavior, and really what we know about it, what works, what doesn't work, and within that body of challenging behavior is positive behavior intervention supports, 80 years worth of research on what works in this regard. But I'll tell you, there is no magic bullet. If you're expecting a magical bullet and a fix and a cure, I'm going to bring you back down to reality. Just like that first vaccine wasn't fixed, wasn't anything, definitely reduced things. Sometimes you need to stay at it. So we're going to talk about that, definitely. So here we are, reasons for challenging behavior. So this is the purpose of the behavior. This is really, think about the payoff for these kids. So social attention. Sometimes the social attention is negative social attention. That child who is a disruptive influence in the classroom, engaging in a challenging behavior, to get noticed by their peers, because that is the purpose of their behavior. That is what's the payoff for this kid. For some other kids, I'm going to upend that desk. You want me to do a math activity? I can't do a math activity. You're going to ask me leave that classroom. And that's the payoff for that. I'm avoiding escaping from that adverse activity. Sometimes it's something they want. It could be food. It could be a preferred activity. And then there are sensory and automatic reinforcement. They do it because it feels good. And sometimes the insidious impact of aggression, the underlying cause of aggression, is because it feels good. It gives you a whole bunch of things, such as status and prestige. Watching a movie is automatic, really reinforcing. It just is an enjoyable activity. Communication, and this could be definitely one, it's a way to express their emotions to others. They may not have their words to do that. For some kids on the spectrum, or kids with trauma, or kids with definitely horrific life experiences, they may not have a word for I'm mad or sad, because nobody labeled that emotion for them as they were raised in a very neglectful household. Something we do automatically with our kids. Oh, you're sad, you're crying. And for some kids, they don't have the words to tell us that they're in pain or that they are in discomfort. And another reason for challenging behavior, sometimes it is about power and control. Controlling their peers or controlling the adults and peers. Now, reduced to kind of its fundamental elements, it's to get something or get out of something. When you see a behavior, what is the payoff? Are they getting something or are they getting out of something? And it could be things as getting that lunch money. That's a tangible. Or getting out of something, I'm going to get out of that activity because I really find it too difficult. So some of those kids, just think about that. And every behavior has a consequence. And what happens after the behavior can increase the behavior. If I interrupt you in the teacher in a general classroom, and she immediately, or he or she immediately gives me attention, that's going to increase my interrupting. You can have an impact where you're going to decrease the behavior. You speed, you get a speeding ticket. Guilty as charged. That will definitely decrease speeding, maybe temporarily, or maintaining the behavior. You know, I love my job. If pay became erratic, so too with my attendance. So that every 2 weeks is designed to make sure that you attend on a regular basis. You often hear about the ABCs of behavior. It's a great way to think. It really kind of helps you organize the behaviors. So the antecedent, what event or action occurred immediately before the behavior. Maybe, you know, I'm presented with a math task. And what occurs then, I menace, you know, the fist. I've seen little kids do that. I've seen big kids do that. And then we would take away that math activity. That's going to increase that menacing. You know, if a kid studies before the test, writes the test, and gets a good mark, that's going to increase studying. And so there's a number of things that we always have to think about. What is the antecedent or trigger, and what is its impact on behavior, and what a consequence is occurring? Now, I brought this up because, you know, as we're going through this, the coordinators and the clinical staff at UPA are supporting multiple schools because multiple schools are dealing with challenging behavior. I'm going to talk about something that's called the sitting event. And sitting events are critical because the antecedent can remain the same, but the sitting event can suddenly turn an effective plan into an ineffective plan. So definitely taking that into consideration. Because if that kid has a bad day, you will too. There's no two ways about it. And you know it will be a bad day, in this particular example. So this has happened, I can't tell you the number of times. The kid is staying with one parent versus another parent. When it stays with one parent, they're up all night to 2 a.m. playing video games. And they come into that classroom. And they're tired, and suddenly you know that it's going to be a bad day, that what had previously worked was no longer effective. As setting event can be a chaotic transition. Undiagnosed depression as well, a history of stress. And it can really make something to be taken into consideration. And definitely some of the proactive strategies we're going to put into a positive behavior support plan is circumventing the impact of those setting events. So technically, this is the definition, environmental or situational factors that influence the likelihood of challenging behavior occurring. Maybe the child's not medicated or on the right level of medication. Maybe that child is tired. And that can explain why students respond differently at different times, even when presented with the same set of triggers or antecedents. Everyone knows I have difficulty with cooking. Even when people say, hey, Maria, it's a science experiment, still didn't hook me in. If I come back from a great day at work, somebody says, Maria, can you cook? I pull out my app, DoorDash, and I start typing in what I need to order, no problem. Next day, I'm tired, somebody asks me to cook. Suddenly doing that DoorDash is a big thing. That's because of the setting event. I'm tired, frustrated, bad day at work. So the trigger and antecedent cooking has remained the same, but my reaction to it, my behavior, is completely different. So think about that. When suddenly that plan is no longer effective, or there's some days it's more effective than others. And it's illustrated here. You know, sometimes a change in staffing pattern, a change in routine. What changes in routine have occurred? Maybe it's an increase in the length of the day or a day of the week. I definitely look at your log entries. There are some days more likely for another. For some kids, man, it's that Monday. They spent the entire weekend playing video games and they come in hot. What are you going to do about it? What kind of strategies are you going to put in place to circumvent that? Changes in home environment could be somebody going back to work, somebody losing their job, another family member moving in. Do not underestimate the impact of illness or allergies. And for medication, are they on it? Are they on the right type of medication? Are there side effects? Is it wearing off? A traumatic event can also suddenly make an effective plan no longer effective for that particular day. There was a child that with horrific background would go see their therapist every Wednesday. And then for reasons that beyond explanation, the foster parent or CFS would drop that child back off at school as they relive their traumatic events. And that child, of course, would have had an epically bad day. So the simple tweak here was, you know, maybe go home after the therapy event because the traumatic event was visited upon the school. And sometimes, too, it's holidays. I put winter there. It's just a joke, but, you know, it has been a pretty great winter. But it could be holidays. You know, when kids come back from a spring break, sometimes they come in. And that first week can be a real challenge as we struggle to get them in. What proactive thing are we going to do when we know that the first day back from spring break could be a bad day for everyone in the building? So here are just a few strategies here. Definitely here, the working with parents to establish a morning routine, start school later, allow a nap, increase fun preferred activities. Are just some strategies to kind of circumvent the power of that setting event. And some of them are just beyond our control, right? There is no, a parent does not have to put a child on medication if they don't want, unless it's a life-saving medication. Then we have a recourse to, you know, getting additional agency support. But we maybe can reduce the power of it by being proactive and putting supports in place. Now, every behavior has a consequence or something is going to happen about it, and we're going to talk about ways in which that kind of keeps that challenging behavior occurring. We talked about escape avoidance. I get out of that aversive task. We know that's going to increase. You know, definitely sometimes, too, something as simple as behavior bucks as tokens, that's nice. They can really hold it in their hand and redeem it at a later time. But just think about what is maintaining that challenging behavior and how can we make it less effective. I've included this here because there, within the 80 years of research on BMOD or behavior psychology, is a, you know, you often hear the term positive reinforcement and negative reinforcement. And everyone thinks, well, positive reinforcement is Maria is going to get bacon and for raising her hand, and negative reinforcement, Maria is going to get an onion. I hate vegetables. And that's not really exactly what the definition of positive and negative reinforcement is. Really, it's about positive is adding something and negative is taking something away. So you can add something desired, like bacon, or you can add something that's aversive, like an onion, and that's technically called punishment. And I think sometimes when we're working with these kids, we're not looking closely enough at the relationship. Are we taking something away that's aversive, or are we taking something away that's positive? And the examples are illustrated here. So let's say it's really, you want me to raise my hand. You add something desired, you know, give me bacon. That's going to increase my raising the hand. But when you remove something aversive, and this is what we tend to see quite a few, is you take away that math task, that I menace you, take away that math task, that's actually going to increase my menacing. So we got to think of ways to make the payoff for the menacing less and target making that task a little more palatable. Add something aversive, as I mentioned, that speeding ticket, that is technically punishment, or remove something desired. I know that there have been times in meetings where someone's on their cell phone, maybe online shopping, and then the next time that cell phone is removed from them, definitely that will increase, that will definitely decrease that abuse of cell phones within the meetings. And you see parents use that a lot. They turn off the Wi-Fi. They remove the cell phones for maybe a violation of a curfew. And that's removing something desired. In some sense, what works really well for us, given the, some of the constraints that we're operating it on, it really is about increasing, adding something desired to that positive behavior. So we're going to do a quick little activity here. I want you to shout out that, okay, I'm given vegetables to eat. The behavior, that's the antecedent. The behavior is I shout and I bite Christy. The vegetables are taken away. Is my shouting and biting going to increase or decrease?
Increase.
Oh boy, is it ever going to, because it worked, right? I'm on my own and I'm just like no one's talking to me. I'm banging my head on the floor. Tracy Eagle, who's not here attending to another challenging behavior incident, tries to comfort me and gives me bacon. My banging my head on the floor, is that going to increase or decrease? Going to increase it, right? So it's a different way of thinking, right? Because everyone thinks, oh yeah, no, that's good, it worked for me, look what I got attention and bacon, right? So that's something when you're going through, when you're thinking about those kids you work with, this is something that often happens. Everyone thinks that comforting is going to, it's not, it's actually going to be negative. We see that, you know, first day, you know, a parent having to take that kid off that parent, the excessive reassurance. Sending that, kissing that kid, mom is kissing that kid like that kid's going off to war. It's telling that kid, you know, are going off to war, really at school, but you are going off. But that is going to keep that separation anxiety alive and big. So it's about being mindful of what's going on and being just aware of that going forward. So Tracy Eagle's talking, I interrupt, I get her attention. Is that going to increase or decrease my interruption? Oh yeah. But what, this is what we want. Christy's talking. I raise my hand, right? Getting the teacher's attention. That works for me. So that is actually going to increase that behavior. We want to increase those desired behaviors, those pro-social positive behaviors. I'm always, when you're working through and you're working with kids, always ask yourself, this is such a fundamental question, is it a can't do or a won't do? I can't do this work, that's why I'm acting out. I can't navigate the complexity of the social relationships, I'm on the spectrum and it's, you know, middle year sarcasm, and that's why I overreact, because I think, well, maybe they pushed me on purpose. Maybe a little social skills training is needed. Or is it a won't do? And for some kids, it is a won't do. And we have to make, we have to increase the level of motivation. And we see that, you know, that kid who's disrupting the general classroom atmosphere. Because really, what's motivating for them is the attention from their peers. And we have to make that, we have to adjust the reinforcement, the payoffs for that, and sometimes I've seen teachers just suddenly engage the learners who want to learn. It's such a simple little strategy, and that kind of diminishes the power and control of that child who's acting out in the classroom. I cannot stress this enough. I have seen a beautifully written positive behavior support plan. It's 25 pages long. It is just really a work of art. But nobody is going to do it, right? I mean, you can't retain that much. So you want it short and sweet. Focus on what is the most significant. What is disrupting the learning that's occurring in the building? I usually use, you know, swears here, but we're not going to do that because this is recorded. So definitely focus on, you know, 1 to 2 behaviors, 2 to 3 behaviors for realistic implementation. You can always go back and target the other behaviors going forward. It just makes it easier for everyone when you have those strategies. So we have a classroom behavior observation form. Do we? That's good. Okay, it is up on the website. So I always recommend using this. One, you're going to get so much data so quickly. And it takes 15 minutes to do one. You want to do maximum 3. It's going to be reliable. I always like, you know, go into an academic activity. It's great that they like gym, but it's not as important when they're disrupting English language arts. or math, those critical foundational skills they need. So at 30 seconds, you're going to look at the referred student, the student that we're getting together to create a positive behavior support plan, and the comparison student. And the comparison student, if the referred student self-identifies as male, then the comparison student should also self-identify as male. And if the referred student is off task, you're going to put a little minus sign. And if the referred, the comparison student is on task, a little plus sign. Then you take up and you do it for 15 minutes. How hard is that? And then you add up the minuses, so it's out of 30. So if you get, 10 out of 30 times it by 100, you're actually going to get a percentage of time that's off task. And sometimes it's a real eye-opener just how much that student is off task. But at each 30 second, you write down what is the behavior. Are they inattentive, hyperactive, uncooperative? And the value of this particular instrument provides you with an operational definition that's easy peasy to measure. Because a baseline is a must. Because don't forget the other thing in that positive behavior support plan, a big thing is it working? It's good to have a baseline before you create the plan, get some idea of how frequently the behavior is occurring, and definitely chart it out. The thing with the diagram is you see the forest and the tree, so you can see the challenging behavior that's occurring in that particular classroom. And you can also see you can also see just the percentage of time. I'm not in the sweet spot, am I? That's good. Or the percentage of time off task. That child is off task 42% of the time compared to their comparison peer. That's off task literally 3% of the time. Within literally 45 minutes, you got more data that you can use to go going forward. Now, this is where we hand this out. Now, I know if you're a resource and guidance counselor, we had you go through this particular instrument. And we're just kind of going to review it briefly. It is up on the student ESS portal. Sometimes people will say, nothing motivates this kid. Well, this will help you identify what motivates this kid. But that's not where it stops. It is also, if adult approval is what motivates them, think of how many ways you can create opportunities for them to gain adult approval. Spend time with their preferred, with the principal. Take a note to their favorite teacher. So this is only going to give you some sense of what motivates them. And I know we had the resource and guidance kids do it sometime in October or November. It was interesting because there was a lot of consumable rewards. Somebody asked, could it be wine? Sure, why not? So one of the things when you go through it, there's a whole bunch of questions. It's going to map onto these areas here. So adult approval, be something, put 100 on my paper, competitive approval, put my artwork up, peer approval, can I tell it lead the class in the class, activity. For some kids, it could be independent reward, give me 5 minutes of art, or consumable rewards, give me skill. And that's just the first job. And it's going to tell you what motivates this kid. If you have a tie between, adult approval and competitive approval, that's actually wonderful, because how many opportunities are there for you to reward that positive behavior that definitely needs to increase? So there's all kinds of reward ideas. Sometimes I've had a kid, it's a Westwood example, Leah Jones. This was something kid was not producing any work, got him to produce work, and this is what motivated him, was spending time with Leah at lunchtime. But there's all kinds of special snack that's going to be a tangible. You've got a competitive here, free answer on test coupon, pick class activity, that kind of gives you multiple things they do. They're going to get peer attention, they're going to get adult attention. attention. It could be extra gym time, extra art time. They can leave 2 minutes early. By the time that kid puts on their snowsuit, you know, everyone's leaving at the same time. Leading group discussion. So it is about thinking ways. If adult approval is what's getting to them, how can we generate that? So this is some of the things I'd like you to think about. Adult approval. What ways can we get the kid to get adult approval? Yeah, I'm looking at you guys. Think about ways.
Teacher gives a sticker.
There we go. Right? Right. So that's just one opportunity, right? So you got to think of multiple ways to map into that. And I think this is one thing that really kind of helps when it becomes a collaborative way. Definitely the classroom teacher being a part of it, because you start to say, okay, this is what motivates this kid. We need multiple opportunities of that. It can't be a good behavior certificate at the end of the week. It's like, you know, you put on this awesome Remembrance Day and nobody says anything, right? You, all this hard work and nobody says anything and you get a thank you note in June. You're not gonna volunteer to do it again. So we gotta think of ways to get the kids to do that multiple times. And this will be a recurring thing. 4 to 1, 4 positives to 1 correction. And this is something too, that you can have one correction, but if they have a whole bunch of positives, it really does truly make a difference. Be mindful of that. You can actually do that there's a positive negative ratio data. Just be mindful of it. You can actually go in there. A teacher invites you in, or a teacher does it to another. You get an idea of just how often you are correcting versus being positive. And it's good to be mindful is to also be positive towards those other kids in the classroom who are sitting there quietly and doing their work. How many times we don't say anything. So it's also be about rewarding them for positive behaviors as well. And as I mentioned, as soon as possible, the reality, you know, you put a good behavior certificate at the end of the week, especially for the young kids, it's meaningless. It's like me, you know, congratulating and putting on this awesome Remembrance Day, you know, event, and it's in June. It's just meaningless. Like sometimes too, that's why you have a sticker. That's why you have high five sign. That's why you have a, you know, pull on the ear, a little nod, something, as fast as you can after it. And definitely, when they get a little bit older, you get a little bit of a, you know, you have the option for more of a delay. But you know, it's sometimes too, I've had teachers put paper clips on their desk every time that kid raised their hand versus interrupt, and then at the end of that period, that kid got a reward. There's all kinds of reward charts. You know, for some kids, they love to chart this. They're very competitive, and it can be really something that you're now enlisting them, because that's a really important part of it, is getting them to do that. We're going to talk about replacement behaviors. Because that's what we want to do. We want to replace those challenging behaviors with desired social positive behaviors. And we're going to talk about all kinds of ways we can do that. And really the focus will be on making it less rewarding and making the rewards for raising their hand more rewarding than the attention they're getting from their peers when they interrupt that classroom teacher. And the way you do it is you look at functionally equivalent behavior. If I want to get attention from the teacher, that's why I interrupt. I love her, I'm just gonna interrupt her. I can't even wait because I'm ADHD. So I'm going to interrupt her. But now the way to get that teacher's attention, I'm going to raise my hand. And when I raise my hand, there's gonna be a high five sign, there's gonna be a thank you. There's going to be a sticker, there is going to be a skill, and that's going to increase the likelihood of me raising my hand. Or you go physically incompatible. You can't swear if you're using kind words. You can't hit someone if you're keeping your hands and feet to self. Another incompatible behavior is thinking about emotions. If I'm going into a rage state, I want to program in an incompatible mood. And that's where we enlist that thinking part of the brain, and we start targeting those coping skills, giving these kids these coping skills they need, something that's fast and quick that they can deploy that is incompatible with that rage state. Because really all of this is focused on removing, on preventing that evacuation of the general classroom. So here we have replacement behaviors, a whole bank of them. Here are some of the examples. If peer attention's what is driving the vote, there's all kinds of ways they can get peer attention in a positive, socially desirable way. Maybe it is leading the group in an activity. Maybe it is reading a joke from a joke book. You might want, just a little FYI, you might want to review the jokes before you let them do it, because that was that was one of the best days of work I've ever had. I think I slid out of my chair, I was laughing so hard. But anyway, that's one of the joys of being in the educational system, the unexpected. So these are all ways how they mapped on to that, getting adult attention, getting peer attention, just ways that you want to target, making these kids engaging, really. If you think about what we're talking about, the positive behavior, success for all learners is giving these kids the skills to be lifelong learners and employable. And it's about giving these kids the skill so they can be lifelong, positive behaviors, so they can be employable and to circumvent the negative outcomes that's occurred. So definitely, sometimes too, you have to walk the kid through the behavior plan, positive behavior support plan, so they know what to expect, they know what's expected of them, they know what the reinforcement contingencies are on. And for some kids, they will need some direct instruction. They will need direct instruction in social skills and coping skills. They will need direct instruction in even raising their hand and even practicing that in the real world. Yes, that has happened where we had to go in and reinforce a kid for raising their hand. It was great, in the privacy of the guidance counselor classroom, but not so much. It was a challenge definitely in the general classroom. So we're going to talk a little bit about, and this is why I just want to direct it, it is about enhancing the quality of life for these kids, because it can be such a challenge for them. So here are some of the things that I want you to look at. What would be a setting event here? Inconsistent medication. And this is really a melange of a couple of kids. But definitely here, you see difficulties with self-regulation. I've seen that in behavior plans. That's too broad. Too broad. Self-regulation also includes shivering to regulate your internal body temperature. I want to know, is it aggression and impulsiveness? Because frequently that's what it is. It's going to map onto that behavior, a nice clear definition, and you can measure it. And their strengths, that will ask for help. If they if that is one of their strengths, we're going to definitely target that like crazy. Because we're going to actually use that when we give them a math task to ask for help to delay the aversive and reduce the stress associated with that. And we don't use their interest enough as reinforcing activities. If they're interested into space, trains, and technology, how many ways can they get their peer attention by talking about trains? It is providing just those opportunities for these kids going forward. Yes, there are all kinds of strength inventories and interest inventories that these kids can fill out, that they can even just circle what turns them on. Your job is to turn them into rewards and help them definitely cope more effectively with the everyday life stressors called the general classroom. So that WJ behavior observation list, it actually provides what it looks like. The power of an operational definition is now you've got something measurable. You've got something with baseline, but more importantly, we all talk about RPI, but this is the responsiveness. Is it working? And as I know, that there are definitely kids for which this is definitely a journey. It's not going to be an overnight thing, but we can and do, with the effective positive behavior support plan, do reduce the aggression. So looking at antecedents, I would say definitely, for some kids, you know, it is that unstructured time. That's where some of the challenges occur. What can we put in place to address the unstructured time? For some kids, it is attention. Or, you know, you hand out a math sheet, and I can't do it. What proactive strategy would you be putting in place to address that? Because you've now kicked me out of the classroom. That's going to keep it going. I've included this little sidebar about aggression because, boy, it is intrinsically rewarding for some kids. I not only have that lunch money, but I feel pretty good about it. We always think of the aggression as a way to get out of the classroom because we find the task aversive, but it is also far more complex for aggression, about controlling over others. Sometimes it is retaliating in response to perceived provocation, like that kid, that classic example of a kid on the spectrum who's pushed not on purpose, but inadvertently. So their challenge is that misperception or escaping an adverse situation, and it can be intrinsically rewarding for some kids. That is what I talked about for some kids. Man, it is a journey for us. It is not a sprint, but more of a marathon. And so here you can see how aggression can be both positively and negatively reinforced. I've got the lunch money. Hello. That is going to be positively reinforced, but it also can be negatively reinforced. There was a threat to my status, and so I acted accordingly, and I got that stress, got that back. So the undesirable outcome was, you know, loss of status. And so thinking about it that way, thinking about ways that we can make the payoff for the opposite of aggression, pro-social behaviors, is the way to go forward. And so this is just differentiating between reactive and proactive aggression, because that's important. So proactive definitely is that desire. I want that lunch money. It is not always just fear. So we're just going to briefly go through this case. I am mindful that we're running a little bit late, but we're going to hurry along here. Definitely, here are the antecedents. We've been talking a lot about them, the escape, avoidance. And so what the next slide will be really just some sort of proactive strategies. You know, you've given me a math task. I've ripped up the paper, I've left the work area, I've walked around the room. That's an escape response. So definitely seeking out assistance to initiate or complete work. That is a more socially desirable thing. We're going to reward that. We're going to get that kid to use a help card, ask for break. The simplest tweak of all, reduce task difficulty. Sometimes, too, is giving them the coping skills, a calculator, or just some ways to be preventative and proactive. But we're also going to give you a whole list of preventative activities as well. So here, we're going to reward doing the work, and then we're going to have it all done. And you can do all done, even at senior years, a certain way. You can make it really dramatic by ripping up the paper, saying that's all done. You can put a real big line, red line, at the end of, you know, the 3 out of 6 math problems. But I put this in the home to school reinforcement system. We have to enlist the support of the parents. And for some of these parents, you know, they are the parent of that kid, the kid that the parent that other parents talk about. And so getting a good note home can really make a big difference in their lives, a way to enlist their support. But also, too, it must be heartbreaking when you get it time after time after time. I'm going to talk about the escalation cycle. You know, definitely a reactive part of the positive behavior support plan. You know, it's got to be more than a safety plan. You know, we can't, you know, really what we want to do, I know I'm moving from the sweet spot, is the agitation and acceleration. Let's have reactive strategies for that. The peak, is for the safety plan. That kid is imminent risk of harm to self or others. And so putting more strategies in place for that kind of agitation, acceleration. So we're avoiding that amygdala hijack. There's all kinds of ways that we can do that. This is just a partial list. Sometimes focusing on using the word we is a good way. You want to get them out of that emotional part of the brain called the amygdala, the one that, the amygdala hijack. Okay, let's clear that classroom. Get them into the thinking part of the brain. You get them asked for detail. I get them to clarify or paraphrase. It's a really good way to circumvent that amygdala hijack, because when that amygdala hijack happens, you are clearing that classroom. And it's always amazing, especially for some of those traumatized kids, how long that amygdala hijack can last. I mean, I've seen kids that, in an elevated state for 5 hours. Oh, that was a bit of a long day. Give the student credit for their small victories. You're starting to praise them. And sometimes too, your ally isn't, don't say anything. Some kids, you start talking at them, and it's just, wait till they climb down before you start talking about good choices or bad choices. Do they have to debrief afterwards? Yes. That's just a logical flowing consequence of that behavior. It's how they learn going forward, but you're not going to get it at that point in time. Definitely progress monitoring here is a big part of any plan. You've taken the data, did it work? And that's too, is something to make. You can't say you're going to reduce behavior by 30% if you don't have a baseline. So that baseline is so critical. So we're just going to, does anybody have a question? Then we're going to have a break. Go ahead.
I'm just wondering about antecedents that aren't really evident or triggers that aren't evident, things seem to be going fine, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, a big blowout.
Then I would say what we'd probably do, I would definitely gather a whole bunch of data, I would do another observation. I mean, sometimes the antecedent is between these things. That's okay too, that tells us something. Frequently if you go back in and you do those three observations, you might see it. Definitely talk to the classroom teacher. You'll probably want to do a more comprehensive observation just to rule it out. The reality is sometimes the antecedent is that child's not on medication. All right, okay, well that's a party for 10 minutes. Okay, now we're going to put the fun in function. And we're going to go through a scenario, a case study, and I just want you to think about, how am I going to address setting events, what proactive preventative strategy I'm going to put in, what reactive strategies, how I'm going to increase that, and just kind of collaborate at your table while doing it. And so this is just putting it all together. It really is about thinking about those reactive strategies. What is the function of that behavior? But just kind of expanding that to consider ways we can make the setting events less effective. So I've made a child kind of the cusp of early, kind of on the way to middle and senior years, but really this could be for any age. Autism and ADHD. Adherence to a medication regime is inconsistent. That is one of the largest challenging events, setting events. What could we do about it? Lives with mom and four older brothers. Works two jobs, very rarely at home. We know that could be a setting event, right? Older brothers involved in the justice system, so a little bit of kind of trauma-ish kind of vibe there. Does go into the general classroom most of the time there, receives all kinds of support, and gets that one-on-one support when available. So you might want to take some of these key things down because you will not be sitting there staring idly off into space, I can tell you, for the next activity. Okay, so here are the strengths and interests. I mean, the reality is I know a lot of you, I've worked with you, I will have no hesitation in calling you out publicly. So here's the overall ability is high average. Being smart is a protective factor. Favorite subjects are math and gym. How are we going to use that door advantage? Least favorite subjects are ELA, writing and music, and I think we'll all agree that that's one of the big challenges we see, is that kind of writing piece for a variety of reasons. But here is a strength. They're receptive to learning calming as strategies. That will be a replacement behavior, especially if it involves numbers. So getting them to use numbers such as 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, way of counting down is a calming strategy, will be something that you would want to think about. Love science fiction, computers, video games, and football. I think those are strengths. At the same time, we know that one of them may be a setting event because there is very little supervision going on. So here are the challenging behaviors, and what goal do we want? Think about that when you're going through a positive behavior support plan. Physical and verbal aggression, hits, bites, scratches, attempts to bite. And if that's not all, and child name calls as well. Has engendered danger, the safety of other students and adults 7 times during a 2-week period. We've known that, we've plotted the data, we've charted it out, so what are we seeing? An increase in intensity and in frequency. Leaving marks on a kid and adults 3 times. So what kind of positive behavior support plan are we going to put into place? And a big question is, what reactive strategies are we going to put into place? And what kind of safety plan would you need? So we've gone in, we've done our observation, 3 50-minute observations. We've looked at the log entries, we've taken that into consideration, we've spent time talking to the teacher as well. This is when the challenging behavior is more likely to occur. After breaks, such as weekends or vacations from school, what kind of supports would you think about brainstorming? What kind of supports are going to put in place to target that? When there's not an adult within close proximity, as you know, adult support is limited, so we can't, I don't want to see an intervention where you don't get another adult, but how can we get that adult a little bit closer to that kid when they need it? And here is really a real life example. As a result of many years doing this, I've kind of called it. It just turns out to be coincidental that for some people, it's exactly the situation they're dealing with. When there is a conflict of some sort with a peer, such as someone cutting in line, or if someone makes a negative comment towards them, real or perceived, we know that that is a child on the spectrum. How could we address that going forward? What kind of proactive preventative strategies are we going to put into place? Because this is kind of a frequently occurring event for kids on the spectrum. But there are also kids with trauma, also kids with ADHD and oppositional defiant disorder, for which this, the injustice collectors, they always see, they're really big about fair play, but they can't see the other person's perspective. All of them can be addressed by targeting that as well. Okay, now in your, do they have that? This thing, prevent, proactive, it's a really good brainstorming way to go. Because really, the proactive, if I could, I'd like to rebrand that. The proactive is about preventative strategies. We're preventing that kid from escalating, that agitation level to that sweet spot, that peak of the towels. Let's evacuate that classroom. And we know that, it's influenced by, events and contexts at which it occur. What is the triggering? But really, I want us to also focus on what can prevent those challenging behaviors. And then considering those setting events, that's something where we don't really have that as an option in the positive behavior support plan. But that may be something in the future. She's shooting daggers at me. But that's something to consider, kind of a drop-down boxy kind of thing. I can feel the rage behind me. That's okay. We'll go ahead. So antecedents. You know, there could be something that, you know, could be a person, doesn't have to be, you know, task demand, a person, event or something. I mean, this is one thing I always like to look at. Are there certain times in the school day that the behavior is likely to occur? Is it the end of the day? What supports can be put in place? Are there certain activities when it's very likely to occur? But also, too, I want us to look at activities when cooperative and social behavior is most likely to occur. The dude plays football, right? So we know that, I mean, if you think about football, pretty pushy game, and yet there's nothing, right? There is no aggression. So clearly, within the confines of the school, that's when it's about to occur. The conditions in the physical environment that were high likelihood of the challenging behavior. For some kids, it is that transition. And we know that that kid comes in hot on Monday, could probably play video games all day. So what are some ways we could target the setting events?
Soft landing on Monday or
perfect.
After holidays.
Right, like, well, we know a kid's going to come in, you know, why be, better to be proactive, pleasantly surprised than taken aback.
Mm-hmm.
You know, let's work with the parent to talk about maybe, you know, putting that child consistently on medication. Maybe they can sign the paper so we can put the, administer the medication on a consistent basis. Those are just some ways, but it is something that really should be part of the positive behavior support plan going forward. So this is the payoff for this kid. And you know, I'm sure that when as I'm going through this, you're thinking of many kids that you've worked with, for this is what's driving their challenging behavior. Gain a feeling of justification when that child hurts someone that student perceives is treating them unkindly in some way. Sometimes it is something as intangible as status. Or something that is intangible as, oh, you know, you hurt me, I'm going to hurt you. And that sometimes is something we always kind of think, we don't kind of think that way, but you do need to do that when you're thinking about aggression. In the past, the student has been suspended for aggressive behavior and goes home to a largely unsupervised environment where they're allowed to engage in activities that are more reinforcing than school. Right, what strategies can we take to circumvent the power of that? Because we know that is keeping that kind of behavior alive. So to the maintaining consequences, how are we going to target, what would you want to target? What is the payoff that kid is getting for?
They don't have to do the thing they don't want to do.
Absolutely, but you know what? Justified. They feel justified about it. We're going to make the payoff for aggression less. Okay, so this is the reasons for the behavior. I would say that this occurs a lot for aggression, is to control others. It is about status, power, and prestige. And it doesn't have to be physical aggression either. Words can hurt just as much. And can control others as well. And really is to express feelings of anger and injustice, and you're not fair. But it's also really a good way for a kid to control the environment around them. So we got to make the payoff for that less. What also, too, is to access a more preferred environment and activities at home. I mean, sometimes, too, we work with the parent to maybe shut the Wi-Fi off at home, which we know that can always happen. So what replacement behaviors would we want to implement? What replacement behaviors would we want to target to increase?
The violent behaviors?
Oh, yeah. Right? Hands and feet to self. You can't hit somebody if you're doing this. And it really is about finding multiple opportunities to reward it, even when they're just sitting there, or when they're no longer using verbal aggression, just making the payoff. But we also need some additional replacement behaviors. Sometimes we're going to target making appropriate social comments. So we want this kid to get their payoff for it in a very, very different way. So these are just some of the replacement behaviors I came up with, but there may be additional ones to think about. So use words to express feelings to peers. Right? We might need a little direct instruction in that. We'll ask an adult for help when in conflict with the peer, right? Because we know the probability of that super aggression, because that dude was very aggressive, left marks and a lot in a very short period of time. And we know that if we can get him to do a more socially appropriate, desirable behavior and ask for an adult to help them when in conflict with the peers. So just think of ways we can target the words to express feelings, ways you can ask an adult for help, and keeping hands and feet to self. Okay, so here are the preventative proactive strategies here. So what can we do about after breaks, such as weekends or vacations from school? What are the ways?
Provide more breaks during the day.
Yeah. We know he's coming in a lot on Monday.
Maybe have a math activity to start.
Yeah.
Right? Engage the brain first.
Yeah. And these are all going to be strategies you're going to put in that preventative piece. But it also, too, shows you the power of brainstorming some of these. You know, because sometimes I'll come in, Christy comes in, Tracy comes in, we don't know these kids. So we need the support from you guys.
I'm wondering if maybe the social worker, if they work over the holidays, to continue to touch base.
Yeah, because I mean, clearly, you know, clearly it is a household where that child is left to their own devices all the time. You know, mom's got to work. She may be the only primary source of income. Brothers don't suffer. Like they're gainfully employed and helping. That's the reality of some of these. And that is a setting event we cannot control. But yeah, that's something to consider.
Can you figure out a way to incorporate football in? So
yeah.
Either like helping you get on a team or connecting with me that'll play football with them, all those sort of things, develop some more positive relationships.
Yeah. But also, too, I mean, there's something about organized sports. Man, you learn to self-control.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and find an engaging activity to do it, because that's too what that kid needs, right? He needs a calming strategy, but also too we need to try. I mean, ADHD is fundamentally a problem of self-control. You know, I mean, there are people who want to rename it self-control disorder, right? Because we can go into that's a side spot. But I mean, that's basically what it is. It is the inability to stop and think.
Let me try and schedule some.
But also too, it works because it wakes up the prefrontal cortex. That is the fundamental problem of ADHD. Everyone thinks that thinking part of their brain is actually underactive. So physical activity is what wakes it up. Is there any other ways? How can we get the adult to be in close proximity?
Seating them close to the teacher.
Absolutely. Or could there be like a kid could raise and like have a private signal, so that's when the adult or you know, if you have a kid who's willing to ask for help, who is using the ask help card, man, you are halfway there. Because I think some point in time, especially they get older, they have to be a big part of that plan. It's about growing up and taking responsibility for their behavior. because I can tell you this level of support's not gonna be out there in the real world. I think that's why the adverse outcomes are so high. It really is quite tragic when you read some of that literature. It's just like, okay. Especially if they drop out, it's not good. Okay, so when there's a conflict of some sort with a peer, so he's misperceiving events, he's always seeing something as negative, how are we going to target that?
Arrange spaces for lineups?
Pardon me?
Arrange lineup by order?
Absolutely, we could do that. That's one strategy. What?
You have to talk out scenarios.
Yeah. I mean, the reality is that, you know, there is autism really is a problem, a challenge with theory of mind, their inability to put themselves into other people's shoes. And there's all kinds of theory of mind activities kind of help them and role play that as well, and engages kind of the guy who's in Harry Potter. There's all kinds of activities. It is one of their fundamental challenges, especially when they're dealing with neurotypicals. So is that real? You know, are you sure that's true, for example? But yeah, that's a kind of a protracted intervention. But that really is how we would definitely address that. That could even be a goal. But I would probably want to really target the hands and feet to self. That's really high aggression occurring. As in, I think we diminish it. Okay, so we're gonna just go through this. So here's what I had, but this is just, you know, thinking outside the box. So yeah, people mention check-ins, definitely, and we know that it's coming in hot on Monday. There's a help card, there's an I need assistance card. It could be, older kids might just be a nonverbal signal to do that. But definitely then the adults in close proximity have to be responding to that. Definitely that emotional temperature, using visuals. Sometimes there's that 10.1. I find for some kids that's just too much, especially if they're very early years kids. If they're early years kids with trauma, that's too big. Sometimes it's that stoplight is really good, the red, yellow, and green. Sometimes for some kids, kids with ADHD, for example, have difficulty differentiating a mad from a sad face, especially if they're very young, especially if there's trauma in their lives, because it's all the same to them. So for some kids, you know, that emotional temperature, you have to actually spend time in helping them identify that emotion. One of the quickest two interventions is when a kid's on their way to, you know, the peak, is to get them to name the emotion. I'm mad. By just saying I'm angry, you already engage the thinking part of the brain. It's called name it to tame it. It is the quickest little CBT-based therapeutic technique that works for everyone, including myself. Okay, you know, you're gonna go with the plan through the replacement behaviors and consequences. And definitely we mentioned there the anger control, guidance and social work can play a role in that as well. Stop and think visuals. Sometimes too, it's just a really good way to do that. Social skills, theory of mind activities. You can actually type that in. And there is a app on an iPad. Something to think about. Calm down room. Sometimes that opportunity room is really good, a break card. And I think there was additional strategies recommended as well. Okay, now one of the things we know that this kid is acting out so they can go home. And we know that out of school suspensions has all kinds of negative outcomes. And so we want to reduce the out of school suspensions for aggressive behavior. The reality is there is a document, oh, hello Coordinator Eagle. There is a document the province has released, and this is something too I've seen on TikTok. The document which we went through and provided a rough draft to those higher up in the food chain than ourselves, what it trumps it is the legislation, the Safe Schools Act, and the Public School Act of Canada, of Manitoba. The reality is there's your emphasis will be on reducing the number of out-of-school suspensions, but there's nowhere is there a concrete directive about eliminating them completely. The reality is sometimes an out-of-school suspension is an opportunity for everyone to reset. I know, and this is me personally, I know that when I was a little bit of a jerk in the classroom, you know it all, and sometimes that out-of-school suspension was a little wake-up call for me. The reality is we want to reduce them as much as possible. We want to have an in-school suspension as an alternative. There you can talk about an alternative placement, an alternative programming going forward, because we know that there's all kinds of negative outcomes associated with out-of-school suspensions. We also know that legislation always trumps policy. So, positive reinforcement. What are ways we're gonna reward this kid? I'm gonna start walking around the room. What? Oh, right.
You stay in your
lane. Come on.
Preferred activity.
Absolutely. What's this guy's, you know, reward? Right, math and gym and. Yes, I saw your hand raised.
I was just gonna say whatever their interest, like whatever motivates them.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Anything.
Or maybe we've done their forced choice and we found that they want to spend time with an adult. I mean, Leah Jones, I was so surprised that of all the rewards this child could have asked for was having lunch with her. Right? You know, she was a classroom teacher, an awesome classroom, but she was a classroom teacher. Sometimes, you know, had, you know, reprimand and consequence. But it really was something to, so definitely doing that forced choice, finding out what motivates that kid. You just have so many more opportunities to really target that, those positive behaviors. Especially if there are kids with ADHD, they satiate very quickly on just one type of reward. So you really want to have a lot of change up. I've had kids where they reach into a bag, surprise bag. I tell you, it works at, even at senior years. They reach into a grab bag and they get, you know, maybe it's a $2 coupon to McDonald's or something. It's about making the payoff for good behavior exceed that for the bad behavior. In essence, that's what we're trying to do. For some, you know, I'm really big on self-monitoring. I mean, for some kids, it's just not an option. But it is really self-monitoring, the classic CBT technique. And it is about getting them to take responsibility. It's about kicking away that scaffolding, because eventually that's what has to occur. We want them to really kind of self-regulate. And for some kids, yes, it is a journey. It's not gonna be overnight. But it really is about them monitoring their successes. I mean, this one kid, it just was total turnaround because he wanted to get as many rewards because he was intrinsically motivated by that, but extrinsically motivated. We want both. It's great to now feel good about your job, but you wouldn't feel good about your job if they stopped paying you. You need both. Just some way to think about it. And definitely making sure, keeping track. There's all kinds of ways you as staff can track the amount of rewards they're getting. Looking at the ratio of 4 to 1, and thinking about all the kinds of ways that they can get a reward. From you know, taking extra computer time, there the kid wanted to run one lap around the playground. I'm would rather walk or sit on the bleacher. But you know what? It shows you the importance of making sure that the reward is meaningful to that child. So here are some reactive strategies. What other ones could you give to this kid? Because I would like to see more reactive strategies than just the, you know, just going right to the safety part. You know, when you start to see this kid, because it just makes your life easier. Nobody wants to get to that level, right? It's upsetting for the staff, it's upsetting for the kid, it's upsetting for administrators. It's a whole, you know, whole level. That kid is agitated, amygdala hijacked, but so too is the staff. So finding ways to target those early signs of agitation. You know, that stop and think, there's all kinds of sheets about that. Classic CBT technique. We've got access to teachers pay teachers, for example. There's all kinds of that coping strategies, really target those. You know, let's count backwards, you can do it together. Giving space, this is a big one, you know, sometimes too, don't talk. You know, maybe be in close proximity to that kid as they desperately attempt to, you know, re-regulate. Ask for help card. When they start to get into that category of harming self or others, yeah, you need to have a safety plan, because that challenging behavior, that definition, was also about the impact on the other kids in the classroom. And that's something, yes?
I was just
going to
say, you want to add also food. Sometimes the...
Oh, yeah. Hello, you've distracted me. You know, I mean, you know, a lot of these strategies about distracting that amygdala, right? And definitely food would do that, right? It really is a good way. Anybody else with any other strategies? No, this is one thing, because this is actually part of the behavior plan, our positive behavior support plan, progress monitoring. And so, you know, depending on, I just put a month, but, you know, it really is a good way. You don't have to do an Excel spreadsheet. You don't have to do, you know, high quality chart, but you do have to put pen to paper, because when you actually see the data, when you actually see that chart, sometimes I'm amazed at just how frequent that aggression is. I'm amazed at just how complex that aggression is. You know, the log entries, I love them. But when you actually graph it, and when you actually see the trends, you just get a clear picture of where the trouble spots are. I'm definitely using this as a way to work through finding out, identifying, okay, it's transitions. This kid has no coping skills, it's a lot, you know, frustrating easily, inconsistent medication. You just come back with a much better plan. And definitely as a team getting together to review that data. And sometimes too, you know, sometimes there's stuff going on you don't even know about. We only have them for 40 hours a week, sometimes not even that. Sometimes we don't know what's going on in the home, and suddenly we see the aggression increasing dramatically. Maybe we need to get together as a team, which obviously would include the parent, and see what's going on. Maybe the medication is not, you know, being adhered to. That happens. Or maybe there's a change in the home, because it's all about that kid having a good day both at home and at school, and getting the skills they need so they can successfully leave our own environment. So here are some things that we know what are critical for a successful positive behavior support plan. You definitely need that strong staff-student relationship. Sometimes too, you know, whether it's the boardroom and the classroom, relationships are really significant. But they are not the only thing, unfortunately. I wish it were, but they are not. It's not the only thing required. I'd take that data, think about some of those charts, and actually we have a rubric to work through going forward. It's just a way to look at what are the influences, some of the ones we've talked about. Is there, I've worked with families, and one of the first things they've said is how they struggled in school, how they hated school. You don't think that it impacts that kid's behavior? You don't think that they've overheard those discussions about the school? Already there's a conflicted relationship. And thinking about, is there trauma in that kid's life? And some of the triggers, we talked about the triggers and the antecedents frequently, it's a task demand. Not always, sometimes it's you restrict my attention, I want my attention from my peers, how dare you? Or sometimes I want to do that iPad, or this inconsistent routines or transitions. And really the big one is, what purpose is it serving? All of her behavior is communicating to us. It is telling us something. We just got to decode it and convert it into socially appropriate language so this kid has a good day. And this happens a lot. You know, once we start to implement that positive behavior support plan, things get worse before they get better. I think all of us who've been working kind of in the behavior field, am I talking to you? I'm looking right at you. You're looking to me like a piece of bacon right now, right next to eggs, scrambled eggs. So that will often get worse. That's the reality. But definitely working with that kid, going through that plan is a really critical step. Otherwise, you know what? It's just a piece of paper. And rewards to promote pro-social behavior. And that's really what we're doing. We're replacing the challenging behavior with pro-social behavior. And it has to be immediate, relatively high frequency, especially in the early stages. We've got to reward the out of it. And especially with younger kids, they just don't have the time horizon to have a good behavior certificate at the end of the week. It's just, you may as well rip it up. And is a good behavior certificate, is it meaningful to that kid? Wouldn't be meaningful to me. You know, ask yourself, that's a really important part. I mean, we've talked about some of these people drawing in this, but is that really rewarding to that child? And that's why I think that forced choice reinforcement inventory gets some sense of what's really meaningfully rewarded for them. There's all kinds of checklists we have too, where they can rate from 1 to 3 what they find they like, and then use that to your advantage. So here is one of the handouts we handed out, and this too is looking at when you're designing these plans. So if you think of prevention really as the proactive part of our positive behavior support plan, is just kind of ways to check to make sure, is there providing choices? Are there clear delineated transition supports? Yes. You know, it really does truly make a difference. First, then schedule. All of that really does make a difference. I like it. What environmental supports are we going to put in place? Can we, you know, are we going to change the array of desks? You know, sometimes rows are great for uploading content and then put in a little activity where they're putting the seats back together so they can work in a group. This could be a trigger, the work is too hard. Is there ways that we can enhance the classroom management? What is the setting event modification? And sometimes too, you know, opportunities for pro-social support. Sometimes I'm making sure that high status older peer plays a role in this plan. I'm always amazed at sometimes we underestimate the power of a positive peer. Because sometimes kids, you know, a peer-to-peer resonates more so than an adult. Replacement behaviors, there's the functional ones, and what desired or pro-social behavior do we want to have that? Or do we need to spend time enhancing their math skills? You know, when you've got a kid whose math skills are in grade 1, grade 2, and they're in grade 11, maybe it's let's not try to increase their math skills. Let's get them to find different ways to enhance their math skills. It's called a calculator. Let's have them cook different ways. Let's see the graph, the impact of credit card debt, and the joy of compound interest. And just general coping strategies. A lot of these kids don't have those coping strategies. I mean, I've talked to kids. I mean, they can only give me 1 or 2 coping strategies. You know what? You can't always leave the classroom. At work, you can't always leave, you know, I'm leaving. I'll be back in half an hour. You want to have them multiple types of strategies as well. And you know, one way to get that self-management skill is through self-monitoring. There's all kinds of checklists to do it. And increased engagement time. What can we get them to do. Maybe the goal is for them to have a good day at school, and they can spend a whole bunch of time doing something that maybe not enhance their academic proficiency, but maybe it's a way to change the nature of the relationship with the school. And here, again, it's just making sure there is a home-to-school reinforcement system, an increasing ratio of positive reinforcement. And the reality is sometimes, yeah, you do have to have a safety plan. So definitely use this going forward when you're designing these plans. Are you touching all the bases, just as a way to make sure? Because sometimes, too, the reality is we have so many things to do. Sometimes our days are like, it's crazy busy. This just, thing about checklists, it just makes it faster and easier to get a whole whack load of data in a very short period of time. Definitely troubleshooting. I mean, just make sure the rewards for socially desired behavior exceeds that for the challenging behavior. Make sure that the consequence makes it less effective, and make sure the behaviors of concern don't result in reinforcement. That kid acting up in the classroom, what are they getting from that? That has become a reinforcing activity. How can we diminish the reward in that context? And yeah, you do have to have a safety plan. There is no two ways about it. And what we do know is a parent involvement being part of that, because they want to make sure their kids are safe. So safety plan is a good thing. A safety plan really is a way to, for those high, you know, you're at that peak, what are you going to do about it? Give space, validate feelings and experiences. And remember, the end goal of school staff members is to get out of it, is to end it. And sometimes the way you end it is not to debrief after it's occurred, but to maybe wait the next day. Sometimes sending a kid home is a really good way to refresh for everyone, because it can be very traumatized, not only for that child, but for school staff as well. It can be a very traumatizing experience. So, perfect. So, if you have, do you have any questions? Oh, can you tell about the...
The presentation and the PowerPoint will be on the portal under the video link, so this recording as well as the PowerPoint will be there.
Yeah. Because somebody commented on, Maria, I can't read this. Due to budget limitations.
Now I have to edit this. I do have to.
I got a great way to end the PowerPoint. The executive assistant runs a very tight ship.